эксклюзив on Fight TV, а также в эфире казахстанского телеканала Хабар. Хайрулла Киш, Казахстан. Ал Сиеста. И промоутерская компания Сиеста Боксинг. Партнерстве с лучшей Беларусь представляют третье боксерское шоу серии Kold Wars. Генеральный партнер букмекерская компания Баримач. Партнер шоу торгово-развлекательный центр Diamond City Минск. Технический партнер бренд спортивной одежды и экипировки Бука. И хоть скоро все важное было сказано, мы готовы начинать суперный Белтенс! Мы открываем наше шоу восьмираундовым поединком в первом среднем весе. We now open the show with the 8 rounds of professional boxing from the super welterweight division. Встречайте первым боксера из Украины. Coming to the ring first, boxer from Ukraine, Виктор Плотников.
Well, good evening, everybody, and a very warm welcome along to another episode of Kold Wars. This is part three. We've had two already, part four coming up tomorrow night, same time. Me, Andy Clarke and Barry Jones with you as always. And this opening fight is an interesting one. Eight rounds at super welterweight. These two fighters, Alexei Evchenko and Viktor Plotnikov, are getting on a little bit in age, but they've operated at a good level. And this is Plotnikov, 42 years old now, with 33 wins on his roster. You might remember him from early February 2015, for UK fans this is, when he went to Belfast and beat Denton Vassell for the IBF Intercontinental title.
And now, all the way from Chelyabinsk, Russia, Alexey Evchenko!
Evchenko's been at this a good while as well. He won the Russian welterweight title 12 years ago, added a WBO European title to that as well. But then in his first defence, when he lost unexpectedly against Roman Slivistov, it looked like that was it for him. He was 9-8-1 at that point, and his assault on the fringe world level seemed to have gone aground. And it looked like he disappeared, but 4 years and 4 months after that, he came back.
Referee in the ring, Vladimir Kavalenya. Боксер в синем углу. Ему 42 года. Его рост 180 сантиметров, вес 67 килограммов ровно. В его активе 33 победы, и в том числе 15 нокаутов, 8 поражений. Из культурной столицы Украины, города Львов. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, he stands 5 feet and 11 inches tall. He weighed in at 147 pounds and 7 ounces at 42 years old. He currently holds a professional record of 33 wins, including 15 accounts and 8 losses from the cultural capital of Ukraine, the city of Lviv. Ему 37 лет, его рост 175 сантиметров, вес 68 килограммов и 100 граммов. На профессиональном ринге он одержал 18 побед, 8 из которых нокаутом, и потерпел 13 поражений с восточного склона Уральских гор, представляющий город Челябинск. Across the ring, with a professional record of 18 wins and with 8 coming by the way of the count, and 30 losses, he stands at 5 feet and 9 inches tall. He weighed in at 150 pounds and 1 ounce at 37 years old, representing the city of Chelyabinsk, Russia, Alexey Evchenko!
So these two just about to be called to the centre of the ring. Here's the tale of the tape. As I said, there's a good few years between them, but there's a lot of experience as well. And these records are pretty real. They've had their share of home wins, but they've had their share of tough assignments on the road as well. That's what Plotnikov has been doing recently. His last five fights have all been away, and he's taken in some good opposition. Batir Akhmadov was one. He went on to win the, or rather very narrowly lose, the WBA regular title at super lightweight late last year. That was on the Spence Porter card against Mario Barrios. Great finish to the fight. Really, really good fight to watch. And Plotnikov has been up against those kinds of guys looking to make their rise through the ranks. And he's in the away corner again tonight. So Evchenko has got the home advantage here, if you like. This match was actually made before the COVID-19 pandemic enveloped us all. So they've been expecting this one for a while. He challenged for the Russian super welterweight title not that long ago, Evchenko as well, but didn't come out on the right side of that. It's Evchenko with the tattooed chest and shoulders, and Plotnikov with the blue gloves and the black hair. Good right hand there from Evchenko early on, and these two made quite a quick start here, Barry.
Yeah, they have. You thought, because of their experience, they both have a good look at each other, maybe, but maybe they already have a familiar, maybe on the circuit they've seen enough of each other to know what each other is about. But just notice that, you notice that right hand, but just before that from Evchenko, there was another decent right hand as well, and just where Plotnikov just brings that left hand a little bit low when he throws the jab, and that obviously is going to invite that looping right hand over the top.
Just looking for a left hand there, Evchenko, to the body, stooping with a jab to the body. Plotnikov just drops the elbows on it, just looking to prod with the jab himself, try and set up the right hand.
It's a good little move there from Plotnikov there, double jab and a right uppercut, but it just nothing on it. Made the effort, went through the motions, but just didn't really turn from the core with the uppercut, so it's almost like a wasted opportunity there for a decent shot to land.
Working those hands there, Plotnikov. As you say, not a great deal of weight on him. Good snappy jab there from Evchenko, just whipped it up from the waist. Just see the head drop back there, as there well from Plotnikov.
Yeah, sorry, mate. Yeah, good little screw shot there from Plotnikov as well. A little bit more snap in that shot for him. You can see Evchenko here, can you just taking the centre of the ring. I know we sort of talk about it a lot, but it's vitally important, I think, especially when you've got two guys who are relatively flat-footed. It just helps you dictate the pace a little bit more. Then he's doing that, he's just trying to walk Plotnikov down here. He needs to be maybe a little bit more active with his hands, though, to be a little bit more menacing, more imposing.
Just looking to shovel a big right hand over the top there, Plotnikov. Got clipped on the inside with the left hand. Good opening round there. Good entertaining opening round between these two. Evchenko from Chelyabinsk, one of the fighters who's made the journey across the border from Russia. And I was given, well, both of us were, some interesting intel from Siesta Promotions, who were on the ground over there, our man El Siesta. But basically, the Russian fighters have had to drive to the border, then cross the border on foot, and then on the other side, in Belarus, has been a bus waiting for them to get them over into Minsk. These are the kinds of things that people are having to do at the moment to get a fight in.
When you read that, did you imagine the bus being really old?
I did, yeah. I did.
Yeah, so did I. Yeah, I sort of went back to 83 or something.
That's it. I mean, we're both indulging in Soviet era stereotypes here, basically, is what we're doing. But you know, I'm not going to make any apology for that, because you get that image in your head, and it just makes it all the more rich. And these two have been, as I said, given their respective dates of birth, they will remember that. Good right hand there from Evchenko.
It's just a little bit more weight on the shots, isn't there, from Evchenko? I think that's the difference here. I think Plotnikov's throwing plenty of shots, but I was going to say they're arm punches, but some of them not even that, are they? They're almost just placed on the target. Just needs to be a little bit more purposeful with those shots. And obviously the problem you have there, when you're only touching the tag and not really punching through it, and not every shot's got to be the one to put a guy to sleep, of course. You've got to have something on it. But when you're just touching the target, that promotes a slower return back with the hands, and obviously that means then you can be easily countered and you're exposed to a bigger shot. So I talked this the other day with somebody about the punch being, you know, delivering the shot, only one part of it, bringing it back is almost equally as important.
I remember talking to Darren Barker about that exact subject, and he was saying to me that his dad, who coached him, of course, always told him, if you're not going to throw it quick and bring it back quick, don't throw it at all.
Yeah, that's right. You know, it's different. You haven't got, not every job's got to be like a million miles an hour, but it's got to come back. It's got to come back fast. Every punch that's not, every time the glove's not near your chin, there's a chance of getting hit. Simple as that. People overcomplicate boxing, especially in this era. You know, boxing could be, it's very difficult to do good, but it's also keeping it simple. Jordan Gilded the other night kept everything so simple and just looked absolutely $1 million. That's a good right hand there from Plotnikov.
Yeah, you could hear that one just slap into the ribcage there of Evchenko.
No one's willing to go. It's good, and they're throwing plenty of shots, but no one's willing to go through second gear here at the minute. Until they've been around the block a little bit, you know, just pacing themselves, and don't want to get caught anything too stupid. No silly shots landed.
Right hand from Plotnikov, and they just try to move in behind it. But as you say, nobody's wanting to overcommit here in the early stages. Both very experienced, with a few miles on the clock as well, so they don't want to gas out early in this eighth round. And both of these two have been out of the ring for a while. Evchenko longer than Plotnikov. Plotnikov got a fight in at the end of February. That was in Germany. That's him there against Albert Kamkoev. Evchenko hasn't boxed since last October.
A bit of a better round there, wasn't it, from Plotnikov? I'm not sure whether he did any better. I think it was more that Evchenko didn't really throw as many punches as he did in the first round. So maybe you have to pace a little bit here. And just, I don't know why, but just by looking at them, just feel that he might be the guy who might be able to change the pace of the fight.
So into the third, Alexei Evchenko on the right-hand side of your screen there, just revolving around with the tattoos down those biceps and on the chest. And Viktor Plotnikov just backing up with those blue gloves, black shorts. He was matched tough, Evchenko, early on when he challenged for that Russian welterweight title. He was 5-5-1 at that point, and had been in with some good guys, and he won that title, and winning a national title is always an achievement, but particularly in a boxing nation like Russia. And maybe it was all a little bit unnecessarily hard for him early on, because, as I say, after he managed to lose his WBO European in his first defence, he disappeared for nearly 4.5 years, and not many fighters come back after that kind of gap. It's pretty unusual.
Yeah, we'll come back with any sort of resemblance of the former fighter, that's for sure. Oh, that's a good shot. Good left hook and a looping right hand there from Plotnikov.
Again, just moves in behind that right hand, throws it, and then gets onto the shoulder. Short right there. He did win back that old Russian welterweight title too, Evchenko, and he did make that return. And that showed that enough, certainly, of the desire was still there. Past the halfway point of round three, they're scheduled for 8.
trying to walk. Evchenko's trying to walk him down here. Well, it's a good left hook. So I say he's not having much success really, though, landing the shots. You know, he's not really. That front foot got to be a little bit closer to the tag. It's got to be a bit more imposing, a bit more threatening with the movements. But landed with a nice little hook.
Tentative looking right hand there for Plotnikov.
It's a good left hook there from Evchenko, and again, a little bit of nose there from the blood. Plotnikov, that's a testament to that good left hook.
So Bell goes to the end of the round, and as he walks back to the corner there, there's a little bit of a cut, I think, on the bridge of the nose. I think that's where that's coming from. They get them back in the corner men all masked up as they have been on every show that we've seen so far. It's something that people seem to like to complain about. I've seen so many people tweeting about why they're wearing face masks in the corner when they've all been tested. I don't understand the obsession with it, to be honest, but
okay. I don't understand.
Yes, quite.
People who are involved in it, like some of the trainers going, well, if I wear a mask or a visor, if I've been tested and I stayed in the, well, this new word, the bubble, as they call it nowadays. But yeah, but that's the difference to me. I don't, as long as the boxers are not wearing masks and visors, it's a non-entity.
Round four.
Evchenko just looking to try and start off with that double hook left hand upstairs, then down to the body.
I'd like to see Evchenko put his punches together a little bit. Throwing the shingle,
he started quite quick, didn't he?
Yeah, he did, yeah, but he sort of settled down. And, you know, he's not. Maybe because Plotnikov, everything he's thought was not really hurting him, so I can understand maybe that, but there's still been some good scoring shots here from Plotnikov. He's moved quite well, he's changed his direction, so. You're not fleet footed, that's not going to carry the way, but you know, he's changed direction, just makes it more difficult for Evchenko to set his feet, but if you quicken your feet and just get the tag a little bit quicker, you can just let off a 2-3-4 punch combination. A bit better from him, right hand, left hook.
When he throws that jab with a bit of snap, Evchenko, it's a decent shot. He's landed it 2-3 times in this round so far, not there, just pouring with it there, and Plotnikov's doing the same thing. He's maybe it's the age that they are, that they're really just looking to fight in bursts. Evchenko started the round quite quick, and every now and again he does look to throw a few. Right hand there came back from Plotnikov. That was a decent enough shot, but again, not a great deal on it.
Almost the right idea there from Evchenko. That double jab, he just needed a bigger step with the front foot for the first jab. It gets him closer, then there's more weight to punch through the tag with the second. He just didn't really move his feet when he did it. At least he's trying to not just throwing single shots, so at least he's trying to be a little bit more assertive with some of his work. Right hand there, just a little short, little hook over the top there with the right hand.
Just knocked Plotnikov back onto his heels a bit. That was a decent jab. You could see the head just snap back a little bit there. And that's what I was talking about when he puts a bit more into it. It's more of a weapon. A little bit unsteady there, Plotnikov, as he was moving out with his feet. And there's the damage to the nose still. Midway through this one, scheduled for 8. That's Viktor Plotnikov just making his way back to the corner.
That's a decent little round here from Evchenko, to be honest. I don't think he had a second and third in the box very well at all. The first he was good. He's pretty good there. He was punching together quite well. I don't think he's hurt. Not the cover, anything like that. Looking like he's a little bit off balance. I think that's just him, to be honest. He's one of those fighters who looks like he has no balance. But he's saying, yeah, he's trying to close the gap a little bit more, trying to not dramatic change, he's trying to let those hands go with a little bit more fluency than he had in the second and third rounds, and yeah, but he took control again.
Well, the trader taking a while to get out of the blue corner there for Plotnikov, so into the fifth. As I said, this one's scheduled for 8, so into the second half of it. Plotnikov with the blue gloves, black shorts. Evchenko with the red gloves.
That's good from Plotnikov there. See that little, just little change in direction? It doesn't seem like much. It doesn't take a lot of effort. But it just makes the trying to quicken his feet now, Evchenko, but before that, he couldn't deal with it. Nice right hand there from Plotnikov also. If he had a little more weight in those shots, it'd be a different story, wouldn't it?
Those hands out, just occupying Evchenko, giving him something to think about, but not a great deal more than that. Evchenko with that lead left hand again there, got into range and then just hesitated.
She's a little faint here, Plotnikov. Does good, you know, he does that side to side movement. If you just did a little feint, I think you draw something there from Evchenko and he could just rattle off a little 1-2 and then move off. I think for someone like him, he's not a big hitter as well. You know, doesn't seem like he carries any power, to be honest, even though his record says he has a few knockouts. But you know, that throwing a combination, then really moving off. Really exaggerates how good that the punches were sometimes. You know, you sort of like throwing the shot and moved away really quick, little pivot on the front foot, it's almost like an ole sort of thing. And that can sometimes make it look better than it actually is. I made a career out of it.
Plotnikov again, just working that lead hand. He's just serving to distract Evchenko almost, as I said, just to keep him occupied so he can't just go about his business as he would like to necessarily. Final 10 seconds of round 5. Plotnikov looking for a right hand there to finish the round. Got caught by left as he just opened up to throw another right hand there. And 3 rounds to go. Touch of gloves with Plotnikov. Not breathing too heavily as he goes back to the corner, but he's doing what he can just to navigate the rounds here. And he's doing so fairly effectively so far. It would be good to see Evchenko just try and turn the screw a bit here if he can.
Yeah, you have that feeling, don't you, that he could. That's the, it's not a bad fight, but that's the frustrating part of it, is that, I don't want to call it in one case, but there's no urgency in his work. He throws some good shots, and you know, it seems like he could be the boss whenever he wants to be. And he looks the heavier handed for the two, for sure, but just that's a bit of urgency and maybe desire to want to go get him, maybe grab this by the scruff of the neck, if you will.
He hasn't boxed since last October, and that is quite a long time. But it's one thing I've kind of wondered about with the fights I've covered since boxing has come back. And I said this on a few of the ones I covered in Germany a few weeks ago, when there was a fighter who was fancied to win, who was there to win and was winning at about this kind of stage. You do always feel that they should try and get the job done if they can, that they should try and put on a show because they've got a good platform here. But having said that, everybody's just come out of a highly unusual situation and maybe they're all worried about their gas tank. I mean, which way do you kind of look at it? You need to catch the eye, though, don't you? That's what I keep thinking. When you find yourself on this kind of platform, you need to take advantage of it.
Well, it's an opportunity, isn't it? That's the thing, you know, because now, you know, more people are going to be watching than ever before because they've got nowhere to go. I know they can watch all loads of other sports, but there's only so many sports people can watch, but there's more people in. So you have more, potentially more eyes on you, so you want to make a statement. You know, if you can stand out above the rest, because there's a lot of boxing being shown now in a short period of time. So if you can stand out from the crowd by just making a bit of more of an effort, if it's in you and if you can do it, then as all these promoters have been saying, some of these guys, you know, the bigger names are not really fighting because they want too much money. So these guys here, it's their chance too. People that go, "Ooh, I want to see him again." And that's what promoters like. Those people at home are saying, "I want to see him again." That's more important than people turning up and paying their money. TV's everything, of course, isn't it? You know, the broadcast is everything. That's what people want to see. That's where the money rolls in. That's what makes you rich. That's all the things you desire when you turn professional. Even if you are 37 years of age or 42, depending on which fighter you're rooting for.
With a bit more authority there, Evchenko. Good left hand there, lead left hand, left hook, and Plotnikov has been down this road a few times, and every now and again he does exactly what he did there, which is just walk forward, walk in and try and grab hold and just walk it back towards the ropes if he can. Referee didn't break them there, he just waited, and Evchenko turned Plotnikov easily enough.
And again, this is where you feel now, if that's good for Evchenko, up the pace now, get the next gear you need to go up now, because Plotnikov now, where he was trying to be, you know, he's a mover, trying to be more competitive, now he's throwing and holding, throwing and spoiling, so he's looking to survive now a little bit, looking at, maybe his legs getting a little bit tired, struggling for pace a little bit.
Decent exchange at the end of the round there. There goes the bell. Both of them putting plenty into it. Quick shot there of our glorious leader, Al Siesta, who's been over in Minsk since this started a good few days ago now. I'm in London, Barry's in London. We've been doing the commentary remotely, such is the way things are at the moment. And that's been interesting in itself. The new technology we've needed to get to grips with, and just never know how long this might last and how long this might be the new normal for, as everybody keeps describing it. In the ring, though, things are as they have always been, really, for the last 100 years or so. Nothing ever really changes in the squared circle. It's as hard as it's ever been, and Plotnikov just showing a few scars there, but it does look like he's going to get through this.
It does, you know, again, in that round, he was just popping the jab and then bringing that shoulder in, getting close to the target, you know, chest to chest. So Evchenko couldn't really land with anything. So, yeah, he looks like more now than that last round. It was the first time he really looked like he was just surviving and not, you know, trying to fiddle his way or trying to nick a round here and there. He was on total self-preservation mode.
Evchenko just trying to keep that head moving. Plenty of movement with the shoulders, with the gloves. There's a lot going on with him a lot of the time. Just throws that left hand, slaps with that left hand a little bit as he comes forward. Plotnikov, again, just trying to do enough to offset him, Evchenko. Not give him time to get into position to punch with real power.
honestly, I think they've told him in the corner, Evchenko, that Plotnikov is knackered. Because you can see now he's starting to cut the ring off a little bit more. Just starting to get that front foot a little bit closer, a little bit more menacing.
Decent jab there from Evchenko, then just looks to try and fake with the front foot, but he didn't get anything back from Plotnikov with that, which I doubt he will. Bit of upper body movement there, bit of head movement from Plotnikov. He's got 90 seconds of round 7 and then round 8 left to go.
It was a little bit more on those punches there from Plotnikov. That would have been a lovely combination, actually, but just not enough to really call them scoring punches.
Jabs of the body there from Evchenko, then looked for the right hand, but Plotnikov slid away to his left-hand side, evaded that one quite comfortably.
To be fair, the right hand, I think that's something that's been lacking in the first round. I think Evchenko couldn't miss with that right hand, and he sort of partially neglected it, hasn't he, in the rest of the fight? But that was his best shot in the first.
Final few seconds of round 7, then just shoots the jab there, Evchenko. As I said a few rounds ago, when he put some power into that, it's actually quite a good shot, but most of the time he's a bit tippy tappy with it. So the bell goes at the end of round 7, and you can see from the face there of Plotnikov that he's found the target on numerous occasions. Evchenko, I just would really like to see him in this final round just raise the tempo, just ratchet it up and see what happens, because he did to an extent in that 7th round, but I just do not see any reason not to go for it here. I mean, what's he afraid of?
Well, he started the round fast, and that was good. You know, he was moving his shoulders, a little bit looser, and it looked like he was looking to try and put his punches together. I think that's what it'll take. I think that might be, that's all it will take. It will be a sustained attack, a combination punch. I think that might be enough. I don't think that's really nail this guy to the canvas. I think that, you know, a big flurry, he's already knackered here, Plotnikov, and the referee might step in possibly. So, yeah, you can see it, and it looks clear that there's nothing that's going to trouble Evchenko with power-wise, so yeah, go for it, I think you would have thought. But also, he's winning, and like you said, it's been a long layoff, and you know, happy just to get the win with minimal or no damage, and the win becomes, no, the win, the W becomes for anything. Good performance is great, and you want a good performance, and you really need it in this sort of climate. But my old trainer used to say to me, from Trinidad, better to win ugly than to lose pretty. And that sort of always stuck with me, actually.
Well, it's,
I won ugly
true.
A lot. Lots.
I mean, but it is true. The win is paramount. It's, as soon as fighters start to think about how well they need to win, that's often when they come unstuck. We've seen that in recent times. It's like when a fighter goes looking for a knockout, it's less likely to come. You just take care of business first. But just at this stage of the fight, I guess, I just would like to see him maybe put his foot to the floor and take what wouldn't even really be risks, I don't think.
Yeah, that's what you were saying, pretty much, is there don't seem much risk at all. You know, that have been really getting hurt, and as he drops his hands and closes his eyes, so yeah. But in stages, he's boxed well. I think in stages, he's put his punches together quite nice, and he has a nice style, and you know, the pressure's been relatively good. Just a little bit closer, we'd like to have seen our front foot. But apart from that, you know, there's good work there. It's just been that one singular pace where you can clearly see he has gears. And you can clearly see that there's no real danger, as you already alluded to, that he would get hurt if he had to take a shot now and again. I think the rewards of him getting a little bit nastier, a little bit more aggressive, far outweigh the risks. Good left hook on the top of the head, though. Not because on the shoulder he's dipped off. A little unsteady there with that right leg.
Well, he's got 45 seconds left to navigate here, Plotnikov. And it looks like he's going to get the job done. It's not been easy for him. Right hand there from Evchenko. Just reached for it a bit. Didn't manage to land it. Was just too far out as he threw it. Dipping low at the waist there, Plotnikov. Just octopus-like, trying to weave his way out of the trouble. Did exactly the same there, just sticking the shoulder into the midriff, and he's using the little tricks that he knows and that he needs to use. With the bell just a few seconds away, I think he'll be pleased to hear it. And there it goes. So that will be a win for Alexei Evchenko, and a fairly comfortable one in our opening fight of the night. Victor Plotnikov has come here and got his work done, got through those 8 3-minute rounds.
I'm not sure if that was from Evchenko. Just listening to that last round then, I'm not sure if that was some sort of professional courtesy there for Plotnikov. Because you can see that he could... Sorry, please.
Yeah, that does sometimes happen, doesn't it? It did enter my mind towards the closing stages, the last two or three rounds, that maybe... Not that the career had been reached as such, but that he was happy just to box out the rounds and get the win on points. And do I really need to go crazy and take this guy out? He's travelled up from Ukraine to give me a fight, basically. So that's what's happening.
Yeah, that's what it is. I think, the more, while you're in the fight, you watch, you think, well, you do more while you get him out there, but it looked just like the last one, also. I thought, see Evchenko's face, he had no malice, no, he wasn't concentrating anymore, he just seemed to cut like a sparring session for him. And I thought, he's just professional courtesy, as well, and then there's a guy here, in his 40s, doing me a favour here to get me out, to be honest. Why would they do it? I don't know, also if you admire that or it makes you angrier than you could have, but it didn't. You know, you look at it, so. He gets the win. That's, I think, the most important thing was, you know, it was a win there for him after that long way off. And at his age, time's not his friend anymore, so he needs to get busy. Yeah. That win will help maybe get land him a slightly bigger fight. And hopefully he can perform a little bit better and go on to... Maybe something else, another shot with some sort of title. Who knows?
Well, he may well fancy another crack at that Russian super welterweight title to become a 2-8 national champion. We still need to get the final announcement. Here we go. So Evchenko with the win, and he'll be pleased to get the fight, basically to get some action in swiftly. And boxing has resumed. Those 8 rounds under his belt will be valuable going forward, that's for sure. And the interesting thing about this card tonight is that we do have some UK fighters on it. Now Siesta's been working really hard the last few weeks to get some UK fighters involved in this. At one point it looked like there might be quite a few. There have been problems, there have been difficulties, but he's never given up. And we do see a couple tonight. We've got one in our next fight.
Я надеюсь, вы сможете поделиться впечатлениями для того, чтобы вернуться с полным вниманием в процесс. Через 3 минуты мы продолжим. Большое спасибо, что вы с нами.
So it looks like we've got a little break before we get into our next contest, which is 8 rounds in the lightweight division between Arslan Magomedov and Lucas Ballingall. Lucas Ballingall is the younger brother of Michael McKinson, both of whom trained by their dad, Michael, from Portsmouth on the south coast. So it'll be interesting to see him. He had to skip off a little bit of weight at the weigh-in yesterday, but he's 13-0. And it's interesting that he's taken this fight because his fights so far have been in the UK. They've generally been against fighters he has been supposed to beat. So he's coming to this one and decided that he's going to take the challenge on board of travelling to Belarus and going in against an opponent in Magomedov, who is 4 wins, 1 defeat and 1 draw. So that's good to see, and that's the kind of thing you want to see from young fighters, particularly at this stage. And given that we've got a little bit of time, Barry, what did you make of the boxing that we saw over the weekend? You mentioned Jordan Gill on that first Matchroom show from Matchroom Square Gardens, and that was a good performance against Reece Pilotti. But there was some interesting fights on that card, with the best one, of course, being Cheeseman Eggington.
Yeah, I think the best performance, and I've said it already a few times, was Jordan Gill. Bellotti, he's always favoured Gill, but Bellotti could have made it uncomfortable for him. But what I loved so much is that he did everything pretty much basic. Did the end of the jab, didn't try and get too pretty with his work, just did everything nice and neat. And for me, I thought he looked fantastic. His performance was really nice, he was put wrong in his flawless in many ways. But the fight of the night, which was on paper always going to be the fight of the night, with Cheeseman and Eggington, and it more than delivered. It was just a fantastic fight there. And in a fight like that, you're always going to be, the loser's always going to feel like he's about to win. But, it was great. A fight you'd love to see again. It's one of those sort of fights. That deserves a crowd, I think, that's for sure. But it was so good, you didn't even notice that there was no crowd there. The courage and the community. Well, let's be honest, lunatics. Goods. We're going to feel is that's the upper fighting. He's got $4 million. So Lucas is going to, he's anywhere near that good, then this might be a fight where he shows people how good he really is. He's up against a guy who's only had 6 fights, but a wealth of amateur experience, and also those 4 wins and all, I think 4 knockouts. So we'll see if he carries a real dig, and we'll see if Lucas can deal with that.
Magomedov, as you say, he's experienced. He's an experienced athlete. He did box amateur. He also has competed as a pro in Muay Thai. Turned pro as a boxer in 22. Some overlap, actually, I think, between his amateur and pro careers, which is allowed now. He picked up a defeat in his second fight. Doubled in your way corner to fight 6-0. Home, lost on points over 6 rounds, so that was obviously a tough job for
Владимир Ковалиня. Но сейчас пришло время представить вам оппонентов. It's now time to introduce you to the boxers. Боксер синего угла. Ему 23 года. Его рост 175 сантиметров, вес 62 килограмма, 300 граммов. Его рекорд безупречен. 13 побед, 3 из которых одержаны нокаутом. Из города Портсмут, Великобритания. Fighting out of the blue corner. Hailing from the United Kingdom. Holding a flawless professional record of 13 wins. He stands at 5 feet and 9 inches tall. He weighed in at 137 pounds and 1 ounce. All the way from Portsmouth. Representing the Bombay Army. Его соперник в красном углу. Находится он из Новой Шкалы. Ему 26 лет. Его рост 173 сантиметра, вес 61 килограмм 600 граммов. На сегодняшний день его рекорд 4 победы и 4 нокаута. Одно поражение и одна ничья. Он представляет республику Дагестан, Россия. In the red corner, the puncher from Mahashkala City. Holding a record of 4 wins, all by nocaut. Standing at 5 feet and 8 inches tall, weighing 135,000 ounces. He is 26 years of age, from the Republic of Dagestan, Russia. Aslan, just be assured,
Magomedov getting a good reception for those inside the Diamond in Minsk, and as I said, I think this one could be interesting. I don't think there's going to be too much messing around here from Magomedov. Certainly Ballingall took up boxing about 11 years old, had a decent enough amateur career, won some minor town titles, the Southern Areas Counties title. It did actually get banned from boxing for a bit for tipping over a spit bucket when he was about 14 because felt the decision should have gone his way. And he felt quite a few of the ones that went against him should have gone his way. It's something you hear fighters about their amateur careers fairly often, and I think that was one of the reasons why he turned over young at 18 years old. I know that diet and weight making wasn't his favourite thing in the world when he was early on in his journey. His dad telling me a few years ago that he couldn't work out why he wasn't able to shed some weight until he checked under his bed one day and found loads of empty packets of hobnobs. So Ballingall in the white and Magomedov in the black, this scheduled for 8 at lightweight.
Nice right hand there from Ballingall. Be careful, just lift his chin up a little bit there when he throws that jab.
Jabs to the body from Ballingall and then just went up to the head. Just trying to inch closer, get close enough that he can let his hands go. Fairly tight guard as he comes forward.
Yeah, he got there though. He threw that right hand to the body, which stopped the movement there of Ballingall. We just needed to whip an uppercut like that, right through the middle. That was the shot he needed after that, right to the body.
That's a decent body shot there from Ballingall himself. He just heard that right hand slap home and he's just giving a bit of ground here. Magomedov, nice left hand there from Ballingall.
Yeah,
and he does need to make sure that he needs to get Magomedov's respect here, doesn't he? That's the key. He needs to be able to sting him, to keep him off, because Magomedov will just keep coming forward. He's that kind of a fighter.
What he needs to do is, every time Magomedov throws a shot, make him miss, make him pay. So when he throws that jab to the body, there's a hole. The left hand side of the face is open, you just got to ping him with the right hand. I'm going to be too much weight, I'm going to overcommit. but you got to make him think about throwing every shot rather than just walking forward, you know, waiting too long maybe here a little bit. Ballingall boxing quite well though, but
final few seconds of round one. Well, you mentioned Jordan Gill earlier, and one thing he did really, really well against Reece Bellotti, amongst most things really, was that he just kept catching Bellotti on the way in, just kept bouncing that jab to his forehead, and he was just never set. He was just never able to get himself set to do what he wanted to do. And Magomedov looks like a kind of strong, muscular sort of fighter, comes in and out with his feet when he does use them, but for the most part he's inching forward with that front foot. I don't think there's going to be a lot of lateral movement from him. What you see is what you get. You just have to come up with a method of combating it.
Yeah, which that was a good level of the other age. I was sort of saying earlier too, I should have struggled earlier on and got a super guy at that time. Yeah, but he's never quick, he walks you down quite effectively, but if you're throwing shots, you can't do that. So I think for Ballingall, yeah, he's going to be turning him all the time, not volunteering. He's going to be on the move and turning the guy under pressure, but not volunteering yourself too much to the ropes. So slide back, pivot on the front book, on the front foot. Making Magomedov turn all the time, so he just can't set himself. Making punch bumps too far out, making fall short. Fire those longer shots through.
That's a nice left hand there from Ballingall. Lead left hook. Just about had the glove up there to protect himself, Magomedov, but still would have given Ballingall a good bit of confidence. 30 seconds.
Good double left hook up the ropes as well, wasn't it, off Ballingall?
Magomedov with a short right hand just gets through there, then just looks for the wider right. But that's good from Ballingall, goes up with the left hand, and the gloves are in place, so just switch down to the body.
Got to be careful lifting that chin up though when he throws his shots here, Ballingall. That can happen.
Magomedov with the 1-2, which just about got there, then stepped in and followed it up, and Ballingall just maybe just switched off for a split second there, just pushing out the jab. Magomedov trying to measure the distance with his left hand and lets the right hand go. He didn't make it.
Boxing well on the move here, Ballingall. Just volunteered himself to the ropes too often for my liking. And obviously he likes to fight off the ropes and he does it quite effectively, I'm sure, but gives the impression you're under more pressure than you actually may be.
Right hand there from Ballingall, just force Magomedov just to move out. I got a good shot of that, but it isn't long before he moves back in again. Looks for the right to the body, and Ballingall defended it well, dropped the elbow on it, then just moved off to his right.
I thought he missed first of all. I just think he clipped him with it. Magomedov.
He's in range there, Magomedov, and he just didn't let his hands go. Ballingall, I think, was glad of that. Just popped him with the left hand and then skirted away out of trouble. He had an exit available to his left and he took it.
Why do you think
he's boxing nicely here, Ballingall?
Yeah, I think he is, and I think the reason Magomedov didn't let go is because he's being countered every time he misses, I think, at the minutes, and I think a little more tentative than his shots go, and that's a good sign for Ballingall. Even though he's doing under constant pressure, I thought he was the one who landed with the most part, the better punches. Under pressure, but quite comfortable with it. That's the best way to do, fight off the ropes, and also one take, turn, coming off the ropes, and fire back, trying to put Magomedov under a little bit of pressure. Just got to be careful with that right hand, that's a danger punch here, but for Ballingall from Magomedov. When he kind of steps in with that left hand, he gets that right hand goal. It looks like he's going to do a snap of it.
It's a nice floor, isn't it? He is quite stiff, he is quite robotic at times. But that's what he's going to try and set up.
10 seconds, out. Третий раунд. Round three.
Being quite loose, a little half a step to the left then as well, just means Magomedov couldn't fire back.
Ballingall just backing up to the ropes. He's in the white shorts, Magomedov in the black.
Just needs to stab a little bit more with the left jab here, Magomedov. Awesome, lovely right hand there from Ballingall then on the move. See all the power's in the right hand here from Magomedov, but the jab's too weak, so Ballingall's been able to counter it. If he stabbed that jab, just stepped with the front foot and doubled it up, that not only puts Ballingall on the ropes, but makes him stand a little bit tall. And obviously when you're tall, then that right hand's more effective, there's a bigger target to hit.
Went down to the body with the left hand there, Ballingall. That was a decent shot, Magomedov. Again, just almost stuttering his way in with that front foot. Looking for that right hand. Every now and again, he looks for the uppercut with the right or left. Probably not as much as he might. That was neat from Ballingall, just banging to the body with his right. Then switching it up to the head.
He blocked well off the ropes there, and the upper body movement was good. Because he stayed there too long, he took a shot. Should be one or two movements at best when you're on the ropes, and then look to get off it. You've got to turn, pivot, push him back, hold him, spin him. Also lovely, that's lovely there, using the ropes there to lean back and whip an left hook to the body. Got a little bit of rhythm to his work, hasn't he, here, Ballingall, in this round?
He has. It's almost like he's picked up a good kind of read of Magomedov now that he's been in there for nearly three rounds with him, because what he does attempt to do is quite repetitive. That doesn't mean that it can't be effective, but Ballingall just seems, as you say, more comfortable with what he's facing here. And he is, from where I'm watching, he's doing the more accurate work, the cleaner work. It's Magomedov with the front foot pressure, and judges can often be blinded by that, but in terms of what's landed in this round, you'd say that Ballingall has had the better of it. Good right hand to finish it off there though from Magomedov.
Oh, for me he's had far the better of it. He's had a really good start to the whole fight, to be honest, but that was his best round by far. Just gotta be careful that he's in a nice rhythm here, Ballingall. Just gotta be careful, you can get just too complacent, that's all. Sometimes when you're in the flow, you almost think you're invincible. You've got to be careful, nothing is close. Magomedov, he just hit him with a little left hook at the end. It's just about 30 seconds to go in the round. Be careful there, nothing. That right hand still looks dangerous as well there for Magomedov. So, that's it. Switch on, stay alert. And for Magomedov, it's just a case of quickening your feet, but getting closer to the target. And that, you know, double jab will do that for you, but you have to bring your feet with the punch.
I mentioned that Ballingall has had learning fights so far, but he's had some good work in the gym. Been sparring down the years the likes of Lee Selby prior to his fight against Evgeny Kranovic, and that was a while ago now, so he would have been a really young man at that point. 18, 19 years old, Ballingall. I know that the likes of Alan Smith and Tony Borg, who trains Lee Selby, of course, they were impressed with him when they saw him in their gyms. And often early on, it's that kind of experience that serves you really, really well. That possibly is where you do just as much as of your learning as you do inside the ropes, because one of the problems early on, of course, is that unless you're signed with a big promoter, then you need to sell tickets, and the need to sell tickets makes it difficult to box regularly, because you can't be selling tickets to the same people every couple of weeks. They're not going to buy them.
Okay.
That's what will be good about taking this kind of fight for him, because there won't be any of that. He won't have to have sold tickets for this fight, obviously, and it's just a different kind of experience. He'll be able to concentrate on it completely, because those distractions they're underestimated by a lot of people. You speak to fighters, and we've got one coming up on the card later on, who I remember speaking to a little while ago, tomorrow in fact, in a senior byfield, and I remember speaking to him on the day of one of his fights, and he said, I've only just got in, I've been cycling around the estate dropping off tickets, and it seems absolutely crazy that can happen, but it happens all the time.
I'm so old, I was boxing on the day weigh-ins, when you'd weigh in on in 12 o'clock and fight in the evening. So I'd be walking around, driving around at midnight, and then sort of 11 o'clock in the morning collecting tickets to get to the weigh-in. Good right hand.
Decent
there.
Right hand there. Off.
Yeah,
just bounced Ballingall onto the ropes, but he springs off them back into the centre of the ring. Forward to seeing Byfield, actually. He hasn't boxed since he lost to Ted Cheese. That's not far off 2 years ago. Good bit of work there from Ballingall, just doubling up on that left hand, and he was rocked back the onto uppercut. His heels there, Magomedov.
It's a lovely uppercut. I'm not sure if he was really hurt there, Magomedov, but he dipped low, but he went right onto that lovely uppercut there from Ballingall. Good shot.
Interesting, just looking at Magomedov as he was just taking a few on the ropes there. He just looks a little bit kind of lost, would be too strong a word for it, but what he's doing isn't particularly working at the moment. And I'm not entirely sure that he's going to have too much of a plan B.
Well, he needs a fight. He said his style that was quite robotic and stiff but effective. But he needs a fighter to either move back in straight lines or stand in front of him. And obviously, with Ballingall, he hasn't got that sort of fighter. But when he does get him on the ropes, he lands with it. A shot now and again, because Ballingall stays there a little bit too long, but for the most part, he uses those ropes to help the movement. There's a tool there, doesn't he, Ballingall? He moves back and then he'll spin to the left and he'll roll underneath. And then fires back, and that's the probably most complete bad here for Magomedov. He's probably not used to people firing back off the ropes. They're probably used to people just covering up and trying to smother the work. And Ballingall is either spinning him and firing back, or pushing him back with a punch. I think it's probably a new experience here for Magomedov.
So into the second half of the fight. This is round 5, scheduled for 8. Lucas Ballingall in the white shorts from Portsmouth, 13-0. Arslan Magomedov from Vakhachkala in Russia, 6 fights, 4 wins, 1 defeat, 1 draw. He's in the black, and it's Ballingall who's had the better of this so far. Nice jab, and then Magomedov lets go with a big overhand right, which doesn't find the target.
Stepped in lovely there, Magomedov. He stayed low, he threw the jab up, he took a big step in, landed against the guy who has a better jab, but then moved away for some reason. Didn't follow up with the right hand. So I think his windows for success are smaller than his opponent, so you know, when you land with a shot like that, then you have to follow it up.
The Ballingall does well there, just managed to turn his man, thumped in the left hand, right hand straight down the middle, half taken on the guard, but it still got through, and he's having more and more success here, Ballingall. Magomedov with a neat bit of head movement there himself, but there's a good combination again from Ballingall, and he is, as you picked up on in the previous round, Barry, he is growing in confidence and really just trying to put it on Magomedov now as much as he can. He does have to be careful because Magomedov gave him a nice dig to the rib cage there with a left hand, and standing toe to toe with someone like him will suit him, but it does look like he could probably win the fight doing that. Ballingall, not necessarily what he should do though.
Oh, but this last few rounds he's boxed lovely, hasn't he? And again in this round really putting his punches together well, tipping down to the body, doubling up with the left hook, the body and head is a lovely little combination that he throws. There was a little point there, he was trying to push Magomedov back a little bit. Oh, good shot. Again, that doubling up the body and head with the left hook, and not quite stiffening the legs of Magomedov, but bet you he's not used to people throwing back when he's throwing. Good effort though here Magomedov. From, yeah.
Magomedov looking for a left hand, Ballingall just dipped to his left and then fired in the left to the body, and again just tries to back Magomedov up to the ropes, and as you said, just a little bit of a sea change in the dynamic of this fight in round five. 3 to go after this, and it's been boxed at a good pace, and Ballingall is just looking to try and raise that pace now.
I'll give Magomedov his credit. He's been outboxed for me totally, but he's landed him some good shots. He's still looking for it. You know, when Ballingall gets a little crippled on the fight, lands with some flashy combinations. He's trying to fire back and still trying to impose his will and his physical strength, but not been able to do it. But the will there, and that's shows a good sign of a gutsy fighter. Ballingall, you know, mixing up here, bit boxer path fighter in the early stages. The mover, the aggressor. So it's a little bit of all of it, isn't it?
So into the sixth, Magomedov trying to take the centre of the ring. Ballingall happy to work that clock face, happy to use every inch of it if he needs to, trying to stoop to the body with a jab. Caught by right hand there, Ballingall, as he was just looking to open out. Magomedov got through right onto the chin, but he took it okay.
Good left hook there as well there from Magomedov.
Little short left hand straight to the pit of the stomach there from Ballingall. Magomedov himself is looking to try and raise the tempo in this round. I think he has either been told or he knows that this could be slipping away from him if he doesn't try and get a grip on things.
He's had a good start to the round, hasn't he? So far here, Magomedov just needs a sustained work. Now it's a good, that's good little work from him there though. It was a right hand, missed with a shot, then a left hook. It was a good clean punch. Rolls reversed here, isn't it? Ballingall's walking him down, but not really landing him too much. That's a good shot there from him. Magomedov was doing the moving around the ring, the biggest face of the ring, and having the darting him with the attacks this time.
Little short left hand there from Magomedov, just caught Ballingall, who then just dips his knees a little bit and sinks that right hand into the body. And it's been a good fight, this, a good fight to watch. And we've got a couple rounds remaining after this, and both of these two have still got something to give here, I think. That's a good left hand to the body again there from Magomedov, and I think we're going to be in for an interesting finish.
Oh, lovely shot there. Ballingall, you get caught with the shot after. It was a lovely little body shot. But for me, it's been Magomedov, hasn't he? Really made an effort in that one. Really did.
Yeah, he had to look at somebody who knew, didn't he, that the tide had maybe turned against him and was flowing against him, and he had to do something about it.
Took there from Ballingall.
Well, Ballingall seemed like he just wanted to just walk him down. Maybe that was the tactic. You know, not so much take a round off for a second win, because I think when you're in your flow, you don't really need it. But maybe just they maybe felt that Magomedov needed making him throw a lot of punches, making him work out, because maybe he established a bit of a pace. So I thought for me, Magomedov was the farther busier. He had to take a few shots, but I think he landed a bit. Better work rate than probably the better shots overall in that round. But he's still going uphill battle.
Round seven.
So into the seventh, Ballingall just working those hands in the centre of the ring. Finds himself backed up to the ropes where he's always been comfortable. Magomedov looking to spear that right hand down the middle. Good right hand. Ballingall again just working around that periphery, which does keep Magomedov turning, which Barry identified as something that he needed to do right from the start of this fight, would allow him just to get set. Magomedov just leaping in with a lead left hook there. Didn't really get home with that, but the follow-up right hand, the kind of smearing right cross hook, I think did just rumple the features of Ballingall a bit. A little bit of a right-hand lead there for Ballingall. And of the two, I think he might be feeling the pace a bit more.
Yeah, he's not throwing as many punches as he has. Still some of the work he's done is quite cute and clever. That's a nice little uppercut there from Ballingall. Just gotta be careful, he's not being outworked, that's all. Listen, the fight might already be won, to be honest, but.
Well, you can never be absolutely sure, can you? He's away from home.
And the other guy's
nice
been coming
right
forward,
the body there for Ballingall.
I don't think he's been that effective. I believe that Ballingall's actually lovely.
A good right hand off the ropes, wasn't it? Just ditched it up from the waist, and a nice left there from Ballingall too. And that's a good bit of quality work in the final minute of round seven, and just rubs in with his head.
Good right hand off the ropes there from Magomedov.
His trainer telling Ballingall to drop down to the body. Right hand from Magomedov avoided, then a good counter right hand there from Ballingall, just cracks him straight on the jaw. Final few seconds of round seven. In the closing seconds of this one, it's getting very tasty. These two just trying to bring it as much as they can, and Magomedov, I think, will feel that he was having the better of the round, and maybe it's slipping away from him towards the end, because Ballingall did some really nice clean work there towards its conclusion, and that's really what has separated them throughout the course of this fight. It's been Ballingall who's done the better work, the cleaner work. The note of caution that we've been sounding is due to the fact that Magomedov has been the one inching forward, looking to get onto the front foot, and with some judges, the judges can tend to be a bit blinded by that sometimes.
Coming forward.
Right-handed there for Magomedov.
Yeah, he's been coming forward and he landed with a good shot every now and again. I still think the work of Ballingall has totally outweighed all that. Quite bad. I think Ballingall's boxing is absolutely fantastic. And in many ways, he's been maybe a coming-of-age fight for him, to be honest. Away from home and up against a guy who's with a good record, who's definitely come to win, who's already shown to be quite gutsy. But I thought he's boxed superb. And he's shown different variations of his style as well. It hasn't just all been the moving and the dancing and flicking the jab out. He's, every now and again, he's bit down and joined a bit of grit. But all that means nothing if he doesn't keep his composure and keep his shape and his concentration in these last 3 minutes. For Magomedov, for me, he's shown plenty of good qualities, but he needs to go for broke on my card.
Well, into this eighth and final round, Ballingall in the white, Magomedov in the black. And it's been a good fight, been a good fight to watch. Yes. Well, that's a good combination there from Magomedov. Just gave Ballingall something to think about. He sets his feet, looks for the big wide left hook, and then a right hand off the back of it. And they're both going to have to work really hard in this final 2 minutes and 10 seconds or so. Magomedov knows and is fighting like a fighter who knows that he needs a big round here at the very, very least. Ballingall is under a bit of assault here, tucking up, not able to do too much more other than that yet, but just as lovely left hand there from Ballingall, that really was. You could just see the head shudder there of Magomedov.
Just got to be careful, Ballingall, because not every shot he throws, but he lifts that chin up when he throws a punch every now and again, and that's probably due to when he's moving around and he likes to lean back out of the way, but doing it close up is a dangerous thing, and seeing him do it a couple of times, and I think he's right what he's doing here. He's trying to smother the work of Magomedov and just trying to, you know, keep it tight. But don't lift that chin up when you throw a shot. Something he needs to work on. But apart from that, I think he's, for the most part, fantastic. If he can keep it together here. Lovely left hook and uppercut there from Magomedov.
What's interesting about this for Ballingall too is that before tonight, he hadn't been beyond six rounds, and when he had completed six rounds, it had been at his own pace because he's been in those kinds of fights. He's done eight rounds tonight. He will have done eight rounds against an opponent who 100% came here believing that he would win the fight, and that is an altogether different proposition. And he's lasted the course well, just getting cuffed around a little bit there by Magomedov. Both of these two tied. Magomedov just trying to manhandle him into the corner.
Well, Magomedov's been full of desire. He's tried to win from the first bell. You know, he really has it. Well over the first half of the fight, he was totally outboxed in every round, I felt. But he's kept plugging away, kept trying, and he's pulled it through back. And for me, he's having a better of this round. Lovely, lovely uppercut.
It was. Great little shot on the inside there. And with his back to us, Ballingall, you can see his neck just stretch and the head snap back. It's very obvious when an uppercut lands. It's quite an extreme reaction that you see. And Ballingall just trying to set his feet and let his hands go there right towards the end of the round. And this has been a really good fight to watch. Very much enjoyed this as the bell goes and the touch of gloves between the two. It was a good match, as we said, between two fighters who both just put it on the line there. Magomedov is nominally the home fighter, and he looks a little bit despondent in the corner there. Ballingall 13-0, but hadn't really been in with anybody. He took the risk here really to travel to Belarus and take part in what has been by a distance the hardest fight of his career.
Well, it was, and really, those last two rounds he sort of struggled. Like, he changed the tactic, I think, maybe in like, round six, and he just tried to maybe just, whether he's taking a second wind, he like, tried to be a little bit more the aggressive, more the boss, try to push Magomedov back, and just think maybe the Magomedov there, you know, with the range shortened. Not his doing, it was a lot of let his punches go, but the desire and the will to win for Magomedov in the last couple of rounds was fantastic. I don't think he's done enough on my card, but he's made a fight that looked like a really, not a walk in the park, but like a one-sided fight on my scorecard at the beginning. All of a sudden, a little bit closer. But a good scrap, and such a young kid here, Ballingall. Well, two youngsters, really, you know, to put it all on the line here. And it's a fantastic learning fight, especially for this young man. First time eight rounds, and you'll know what it takes now that you have to dip into the well. Certainly in this fight, you have to dip into the reserves. He did struggle for pace every now and again, but he grit his teeth and he fought through it and took a few good shots of a guy who obviously can whack a little bit and never once looked like he was gonna falter. And at stages, some of his boxing was just beautiful to watch.
That's his dad there, just trying to get those gloves off, and he'll be awaiting the announcement from our MC, who is just getting those scores collated from ringside. Ballingall on the right hand side, they're undefeated, 30 fights, 30 wins, but this by far the stiffest opposition, the most challenging all round scenario that he's taken part in. This. Oh, here he comes.
Just before, give a round of applause to these fantastic boxers, Lucas Ballingall and Arslan Magomedov. The judges' decision. Внимание, судейское решение. Chad Chimidov. 78-74, 78-74. Judge Krublik. 78-75.
Judge Vistalov, 78-74. By unanimous decision, the winner is Red Arslan. Well, that's... I just can't agree with that. 6-2 on two of the cards. 5-2-1 drawn on the other card, and he's been given credit there, Magomedov, for coming forward, and that was what I mentioned throughout the course of the fight, because it is always a worry that the fighter coming forward is given too much credit for just coming forward. I'm not saying that he didn't do good work during the fight, because he did, but the better work, the cleaner work, was done by Lucas Ballingall, and he has been shafted on the scorecards there, for want of a better phrase.
I think so. Listen, Magomedov finished the stronger, and he possibly won the last three rounds, so he made it a lot closer. But before that, I didn't give him a round. He landed with some decent shots coming forward, and he was coming forward, but that was it. You know, he was being outboxed, and I worried about that. Not just coming forward in the judge's ear, but when you land with one good shot or maybe two good shots in a row, you forget about the 15, 20 shots that you've been caught with once you're coming forward. That's how we see it, that's how I certainly saw it. It was a lovely display from Ballingall, but we're not doing it, of course. It was what we think is almost irrelevant.
That's true, that's absolutely true. It is something
you've got to say what you think you've seen. I thought he was very, very unlucky there. I thought he got swept. He struggled at the end a little bit, but he's a young
kid. It does raise as well what I think is one of the really contentious or problematic things about boxing scoring, which is that to win a round, it's about landing clean punches, and there should not ever be any confusion about that. That is not a subjective thing. It's not what you like. Whoever lands the greater tonnage of clean punch, then they win the round.
I sort of agree with you, Ant, but I also don't quite think it's that simple, because if it was that simple, then it would just be the people scoring. And I don't think that works. I do think it is about punches landed ultimately. And it can be weight the punches, can have, you know, what's more?
That's what I mean though by tonnage of punch. It's not about the amount of punches you land, as in numbers, or you're right, you could do it by punching box, but it's a debate that's been going on for a really, really long time, and it does seem to be the case that a lot of judges they just do like the fighter that comes forward.
My worry is always
aggression has to be effective.
My worry has always been
the sport wants to move with the times, and I understand that. You have to stay relevant, you have to move with the times. But, so everything now is immediate. There's no apprenticeships, don't exist anyway. People want success today, they want results today. So they don't want to see pure boxes as they used to years ago. They want to see knockouts, of course. So it's nothing like a toe-to-toe war. So I'd watch Hagler and Hearns over any other fight. But the beauty of boxing is a thing of the whole, and I don't want to lose that because judges don't be voting for guys who are aggressive. Aggression should be rewarded in many cases, but you just got a guy. If you've got a good chin, then you just walk forward and you're the best fighter on the planet. Is that what it takes?
Yeah, and that's really what I've been driving at. Aggression is of course, it does count. It's part of it, but it has to be effective. And I feel for most of that fight that it was that effective from Magomedov. But all in all, that is still an experience that Ballingall will learn a lot from.
And Magomedov did really well, by the way. It's not his fault, but he did really well, didn't he? I think he still goes to quick determination, some good shots, always kept fighting, and finished the stronger. But yeah, Ballingall was a winner for me.
Baksana is getting everybody coming to the ring first from the United Kingdom, Conrad Stempkowski.
But came back last July. So touch of gloves, final instructions for these two. Baysarov on the left-hand side there, with the dark hair and beard. And Stempkowski with the shaven head, who was stood on the right. And as I said, Stempkowski in the dark shorts, Baysarov in the red and white. And he does want to go out with a win when he finally hangs them up, Stempkowski. That's one thing that he's been saying during the course of the week. So maybe tonight is going to be that night. Maybe he will go out here looking for the victory away from home and then look to call it a day.
That'd be a great finish to the career, wouldn't it? Just you know, finish having a great win away from home against a guy who's only lost one in 11. Not a prospect then. You'd finish a happier man, wouldn't you? Oh, good right hand.
Just set his feet, dug his toes in for that one. Baysarov just trying to keep that head on the move. Decent left hand on the inside there too. Baysarov though just backs him up to the ropes.
That's good there from Baysarov. Good head movement. He needs that roll and dip, doesn't he, to come forward. Not short the guy.
Our spies around the hotel have been telling us that Baysarov has looked like a guy who struggled with the weight a bit. But the last two or three days have been quite painful for him to make it, as he looks to try and step on Stempkowski again there. He's trying to keep that head on the move. There's a good left hand on the inside there from Baysarov.
A couple of good left hands he's landed with there. So he dips into it, and that's what makes it impressive. He's not loading up, just dipping, turning the shoulders, and every time he comes back, he comes back with a hook.
Well, the Stempkowski corner telling him to get his hands up and not to let Baysarov set himself. I think they're seeing a few warning signs in the first round here, and I think I might be too. He does stand quite tall at times, Stempkowski, and Baysarov is just looking to swarm all over him.
Yeah, if he punch, if he's going to punch, you got to punch from there, from that distance there, no, from far away. It's just a little bit more weight than the jab. But the jab's, if the jab's weak, Baysarov's just going to wall through. He's going to break it and come through with his hooks. Also for Stempkowski, it's the footwork is going to be important for him to keep Baysarov off. Plenty of pivoting on the front foot. I don't know whether that's it. That's in his repertoire.
Touch of gloves between them at the end of the wrap. Entertaining opener. This one's scheduled for 6. And Baysarov looks a muscular kind of campaigner. He will just look to try and get onto the inside and get to work. Exactly there, that was a good left hand.
I thought it was good. I think at the beginning of the round, he got caught with the right hand. Well, here we go, here might be a little bit of an upset, but I think... Sure, he's not just aggressive, it's a good movement, isn't it? That gets him in the range. He's not with the punches, and he brings those feet in close really quick and uses that different roll quite effectively. And when he gets inside the edge, he's busy with the hooks. And he's made Stempkowski feel like he's under pressure to take the weight, and that's either going to make him go into his shell or run out of steam.
But he keeps that head on the move, doesn't he, Baysarov, and kind of swaggers with those shoulders. Just doing it exactly there, just that lateral movement from the waist. It's not massive, but it's enough to mean that it's difficult for Stempkowski to find him with the jab, just bobbing and weaving in that good kind of relaxed rhythm onto the inside, and then that's when he looks to unload. Left hand gets in again, doesn't it, round the back of the glove, just managing to sneak it in.
He's nice and loose, isn't he? That's what I like about him. I think he doesn't load up with anything, he's just using that forward momentum to let the punches go. So turn it on the shoulders and the waist, everything's quite effortlessly, and that means he can be busier. Good shot.
Stempkowski just stepped into that uppercut, yeah. And it was a decent little shot.
Obviously, when you've got a smaller guy who's coming at you low, then the uppercut's the punch you throw. The reason you don't throw it all the time is because it's a punch, it's a really hard punch to get accuracy with, and if you miss, you can be in trouble, you can be really exposed, so you have to throw it with confidence.
Just short with the right hand there by Baysarov. It didn't work his way in that time. The movement that we'd seen up until that point wasn't quite there. Decent looking right from Stempkowski, who has done a pretty good job of keeping him off, actually, in this second minute of the round. Things looked a little bit ominous in the opening 60 seconds.
Just like to see Baysarov, you know, when he gets close, do a little bit of a Hatton or a Tyson. And when they would move around like that, that half moon around the body, so you get different angles. So when you get close, you work away and then just spin around the body. When you stay close, you don't move back. You'd almost head on the chest, but you're pivoting around, and it just gives you a different angle then for the hook and the uppercut. And also, the opponent can't fire back, and he has to turn to look for you. And he has that sort of style where he's nice and loose. I think he could do that. There, now he's there now. He throws that hook. If he takes a little spin down to his right, then you've got a hook and an uppercut there, right on the middle of the target.
Decent little 1-2 there from Stempkowski, just clipped Baysarov, and now you point that out, it does seem quite obvious He comes in kind of front on, square on almost, but moving that head, and then just stays exactly there. You mentioned Hatton, and he used to love that step to the right-hand side, left hand, smash into the pit of the stomach. And it was so effective.
And Tyson is a master, you know, obviously Tyson had a fantastic jab, so get it, but when he got in close, very, very, only in the late years, he would just stand in front of the rear and away. He was equal from the left to the right, to the left to the side of your body, so you couldn't even fire back. And you then covering up, you didn't know where he was. And he drew with so much speed that, you know, that everything was the sharp movements from him. So you run to your left, you put that uppercut in, that right uppercut, and you spin on to your right hand side, and you left to into the body. How did you stand against that? And I can see this kid not nowhere near as good as that, of course, but to do that sort of thing, especially as a guy like Stempkowski here, who stands nice and tall for him against the ropes.
We mentioned that kind of Bobby Reed peekaboo style almost, and that was the kind of method that the Customato in particular, who trained Tyson or oversaw Tyson early on, particularly used to favour. Does require a lot of strength. It's that lateral movements. Well, I'm told, I've never done it myself. It's tiring.
It's tiring, but you train for that, don't you? It's more tiring if you don't train for it. You can't. No, that's and then you try and do it. But you know, if you have that sort of style, then you should be training for that. He's not criticising the kid. He's boxing well. It seems like he's boxing well, but he should be doing what I'm telling him, of course. He's doing all right.
Well, he just leapt in with that lead left hook there. And Stempkowski just pushing out that lead hand, that left hand. Just got a little bit more pep on the jab that time, but then looks to try and cover up. Baysarov, good range there, but again, it's what you've been saying there, Barry. He's kind of front on, square on almost, and not able to get maybe as much purchase on those as he might.
But my worry is people can fire back for him. Now you want to see the kid improve, don't you? You want to see him get better. You just feel that people can fire back. And obviously, you know, if you've got someone who has been more of a dig or more ambition, then they're firing back with other combinations or heavier shots or smarter punches. That's a little right-hander, though, from Stempkowski. But he's just been smothered, isn't he? Yeah, a little bit.
Not quite sure what that was about. There was an apology there from Stempkowski. The referee did seem to be getting involved, and Baysarov did the gentlemanly thing and left him alone there as he was bowing in front of him. Baysarov just looking to try and get into range there again. Stempkowski manages to get hold of him into the final minute of round three, and maybe just signs here that the struggles that he's had with weight by Baysarov might be real, because he looks quite spent for halfway through a six rounder.
Yeah, just the edges are a little bit raggedy, aren't they? He's not sharp with his movements in the first couple of rounds. I mean, yeah, he looks just a little bit more laboured and. And not as smooth as this work.
I think there's a bit of marking up around the right eye of Stempkowski, looking to aim that right hand there by Baysarov. Didn't quite manage to land it. Then he's happy to get onto the shoulder and have a little bit of a breather. Final few seconds of the round. There goes the bell, touching gloves. So midway through this one, scheduled for six, Baysarov, who's in control, but look at him there on the ropes. He's leaning right over on the ropes. He's absolutely knackered by the look of it. And Stempkowski taking a seat. Should be encouraged by that.
Do you know what? Some trainers who I know, amateur and professional, if you came back after three rounds like that, they would say, don't come back for the next round. I don't want to see you. Because that's the reflection on the trainer. Or the boss. If he's smashed after three rounds, and people say, what are they doing in the gym? Why is he so tired? Obviously, weight can do that to you. But discipline is as important, or more important, than talent in this sport. This discipline, dedication, all those things that you need to achieve and need to have to be successful. And to making weight correctly is a discipline. I might top all the disciplines in the sport.
It's that old mantra, isn't it? Hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard. Often repeated cliches, it's absolutely true. We talk in boxing sometimes. Well, we don't, I wouldn't say, but others might, about it being one of those sports where on their night anyone can beat anyone. That isn't true if both fighters are prepared correctly, but a more talented fighter can lose to almost anyone if they haven't prepared right in a professional ring, because...
I think you're right, it is, you have to prepare right, I've known some fighters with less talent but more determination and application go on to have hugely successful careers and beat people who they shouldn't even be in the ring with, let alone beat. And that's the beauty of the sport, of course.
Minute into round four. I think it's one of the things that is still just so attractive about it. Stempkowski just doing a good little bit of work here. Nice uppercut, then throws the right cross, and Baysarov just being pushed back to the ropes, trying to keep his head on the move.
He's capitalising on the mistakes that Baysarov's making. That's what he's doing, to be honest. He's jumping in too far out now, because when you're tired, especially with weight, it makes you lethargic. That's good for the time, dude. It just plays message with your timing. And your timing, then that message with your judgment of distance. And when you're jumping into shots, that has to be spot on. He can feel it, can't he? Yes, Dembskowski. He can feel that sound was tiring.
Well, he's looking for big shots there as well, isn't he? The Russian big swinging overhand right, which you would have seen coming from way back. And there's a little bit of weariness about Stempkowski as well, but when he took a seat at the end of that previous round, he would have had a very clear view of Baysarov adopting the kind of pose you see people adopting after throwing out time every Friday and Saturday night. He looked like he might be about to be sick almost, but I'm having a bit of fun. He wasn't quite in that bad a state, but as you said, it's not a good look after three rounds, but he's looking to try and dig in the final 30 seconds of round four here, but a couple of big punches he went for there and then just collapses straight onto the shoulder.
That's the problem. He's fighting in spurts now, which is, listen, if your tank's a bit empty, at least you are fighting in spurts is good enough. But the problem is there, when he's putting so much energy into you, he's taking a gobs of deep breaths and he's putting so much energy into these few attacks that he's doing. If you're missing, then... It kills you, really drains your energy. Stempkowski, if you fair one, he's made his teamwork hard, he's perfect for the pace of it, but I'm disappointed here in Baysarov because he looked really good the first couple of rounds. Especially that first round, I thought that was a lovely movement, the upper body movement, he rolls into the shot and he starts to relax. He's unraveling, he's going to win the fight for sure, but he's unraveling as he is now a little bit, he's unraveling, that's down to discipline, and chain on him.
Well, bit by bit that body movement just slowed down really from the second round onwards, and I outlined his career at the start, and I guess it still is at the early stages of what you describe as comeback. It was March 2017 that he lost to Silverio Ortiz, and then he came back last July, so it was over 2 years that he was out. He's 30 now, so he must have thought long and hard about whether he wanted to give it another crack. He's decided that he does want to, but he's not going to get very far if he doesn't really knuckle down in the gym. Odd circumstances at the minute, of course, we know that, because although fighters have still been training throughout lockdown, it's not quite the same, and he's looking to dig in here, and he is going to win this fight unless Stempkowski finds one from somewhere and knocks him out. But it's obvious what needs to be improved here, really, and it's one of the most basic things there is. Although in this round that upper body movement is looking a bit better, but it's short-lived.
you know, with this sort of style, and it's effective. And I think he's a good little fighter. I think he could be really effective. Just a few little adjustments, and I think he's hard to beat. But he's hard to beat. But a guy you'd look at, you think you'd box him quite comfortable. I think you'd be surprised once you were in there with him. He has that sort of style. But you have to be fit and disciplined to do that sort of style, because you're the one, like you said, you have to work very hard. And you have to be strong. Legs have to be strong. Can you stay in low and your twists and turns and pivots?
Nice energy here.
Midway through the round, Stempkowski a little bit laboured, but he's coming forward here. He's just looking to try and have a little bit of a go. Putting his hands together. He's quite mechanical, isn't he, in his movement, Stempkowski, but he's looking to try and do some damage here if he can. Baysarov just pushes it back and goes to try and unload, but the Reading man has his gloves up.
He's shattered, isn't he, by Sarov? He's absolutely knackered.
He is. He's on gas. He's on fumes. He has been for a while.
A guy who's winning with ease, he lands with two shots and he holds on. Stempkowski miss quite easily there. Two dips in a row. Or two dips in a pullback, I should say.
So, closing stages of round five. And again, this has been a decent enough fight to watch. Well, that was a bit cheeky. He missed with it, which was probably just as well, because the referee had issued the call to break there. There goes the belt at the end of round five. There's just one more remaining, and I think they'll both be perfectly happy about that. A little bit of a stumble there from Baysarov as he goes back to the corner.
We haven't seen a fighter like that. Baysarov wins, being over the ropes. I can't remember the last time I've seen a fighter like that in a fight. Whilst the fight was going on, which you've been wrong, so I can't remember.
Nor me, it's when a fight finishes, then yeah, but I mean, in between rounds, like you say, it's surprising that the trainer doesn't just slap him almost and plonk him down on the stool and just say, listen, you can't be doing that. Psychologically, it gives your opponent a big lift, but you never quite know what the operation is in the corner, do you?
You should see that as an amateur on Sunday morning. There's always sparring Sunday mornings as an amateur. And you see some of the older kids who smoked, and the trainer knew they smoked, so he'd have them spar it, and he'd have them loads around, and you could see him leaning over the ropes, coughing, and tired because they'd been out the night before, and he knew it, and he didn't care about the spar. It wasn't quality; it was just, I'm just gonna like really make these kids
punishment.
Yeah, punishment for messing around, yeah. Not a professional athlete like Baysarov is, who, and by the way, he's good. If he could replicate the first round in every round, box that way, with a little bit, and work on that, then he's a hard man to beat. But this, a guy who tires after two rounds in a six-round fight, when he hasn't really done lots, then that's not an athlete, is it? For sure.
Stempkowski in the dark shorts there, just setting his feet and looking to climb into a right hand, followed by a left. A couple of minutes remaining here by Sarov in the red and white. He's winning this fight. He's going to win this fight. And as Barry has said, he's got some tools, definitely. He's got some ability. But he needs to sharpen them.
Just
goes for a walk.
Yeah, and look out the ropes as well. He's looking to along with the left.
Just leaning in, grabbing hold of Stempkowski, looking to try and barrel him back into the blue corner if he can. just over a minute remaining. Stempkowski walking forward. Credit to him. He could have taken this easier if he wanted to, given the condition that his opponent's in, but he's chosen not to. He's always second favourite in this race. It was a decent body shot. Baysarov just launching a combination there, and then just dips low at the waist and looks to try and cover up. Thirty seconds to go. Stempkowski still throwing. And these two finishing this fight in an interesting kind of fashion here, really. It's almost like watching the end of a 12-round fight where it's in the balance and they both know it, and they're both just running on empty, fighting on instinct, trying to see if they can just get that one meaningful one in to nick them the fight. Whereas Baysarov is going to win this, and we all know he's going to win it, but Stempkowski, as I said, he's put his shoulder to the wheel there and really put in some effort, which does make me wonder whether that could have been his last one. Maybe he wanted to just give it everything in there, pour it all out, before he decides to hang them up. I could be wrong, but I know that he's thinking about it, certainly.
Well, he probably couldn't believe it. Luckily, from Richie, from after the second half, I said, the wheels fell off pretty much. You know, he's still winning the rounds, but he went from being it's going to be a hard night to this guy just looking for more rest than I am. He's looking to hold more than I am. I could probably enjoy those last couple of rounds there. Stempkowski, even though he probably had a good little time in there because the guy was just so poorly conditioned. He gets the win, and hopefully it was just because of the pandemic and the end of the training camp, we all get the motivation and we've got the hope that there's reasons for it. So whatever talent you have, however far it's going to take you, if you're not fit or you're not making a weight, you can't fight to your best of your abilities, then you're doing nowhere.
Yeah, absolutely. If he's not prepared to work harder in the gym and get fitter than that, then he may as well not bother. And we'll find out with his next fight whether that indeed is the case or not. But if you were training him to, that's what you have to tell him. You would just have to say, look, you can fight, but if you're not going to work in the gym, then I can't, stop wasting my time.
And if you lose weight, you would say right now, get me that fight. If you just seen the first round, that's all you see, you go, I wouldn't fancy 8, 10, 12 rounds of that, to be honest. That'd be a nightmare. He's sharp, and he's right on you, he rolls, he's had to get clean. But then you watch it from half and hit the second round on, and if you just seen that, you would just say, I couldn't beat this guy, I should pack him. Because he's got no conditioning, he's so tall. But the first round, he looked fantastic, so you know it's in there, he had it. Gotta get fit.
Господа, ladies and gentlemen, judge's decision. Судейское решение. Judge Коваленя, 60-55, 60-55. Judge Круглик, 59-55, 59-55. Judge Веселов, 58-56.
By unanimous decision, the winner is Red Ranzon. Gets the win by Sarop. So getting a bit of joy on the cards there. Got one round with one judge, two rounds with the other, and the share of one with the third and final judge. As I say, he put plenty into that, and we've had our say on Baysarov. There's no need to labour the point. He's taken the microphone off the MC to thank this Belarusian crowd in Minsk. I would love to be able to translate this for you, but I'm afraid that is not possible. So just while we wait, Barry, somebody who caught my eye at the weekend and has done for a while, It's Lyndon Arthur. Lyndon Arthur against Dex Spellman on Friday night on the BT show. I thought that was a good, polished, skillful performance from him. And that fight against Anthony Yard, if it gets made, it's a very interesting fight, because Kovalev aside, you have to say Lyndon Arthur would be by distance the best fighter that Yard's been in with.
And it would be his best win if he was the beater. For sure, yeah, it would. Just the fact that Yard, I didn't get the wrong that he ever stopped Kovalev. He's competitive in every round. I know Kovalev's not the same fighter he was, he's way past that, but he's still better than most, than almost everyone else, to be honest. So, the fact that he was competitive, and even the rounds he was losing, showed that he was the level that he hadn't really been anywhere near before. It was a massive risk with Yard in that fight, but it almost paid off. But, yeah, the Arthur fight, so it's a step up for Arthur, that's how you feel. So you're right, he would be the best, I mean, he'd be the best win on the record by a stretch. But, and it's goes in, I think, it's a massive thing, of course it is. My brother was in with Arthur, he's really good, and he's got a lovely relaxed style, but you have to force him to do stuff sometimes. Do you know what I mean? You have to force him to get him out of it sometimes. He looks, sometimes he's almost too relaxed.
I know what you're saying, and he's got that nice jab on him, and that'll need to be working overtime against someone like Anthony Yard. What he does tend to do is he does tend to retreat to the ropes a bit and slip and slide, and I think that could be a massive mistake against someone like Yard, because he'll just swarm him, and he's got that fairly phenomenal upper body strength that most fighters quite simply don't have, and he can't be putting himself in positions where he's just allowing him to use it, really.
No, and they're habits, though, because you do it in the gym and you're making people miss up the ropes, and it feels great when you do it, right? So you feel really clever when you're sat on the ropes and making people miss. You feel, I'm Ali or I'm Floyd Mayweather. But in a fight scenario, even though it can work, it doesn't always look great. And also, it's hard to push off the back of the rope. When you're on the rope, you inevitably square up, because the ropes are flat, so you have to square up when you sit back on it. And that means, everything from your taking a shot to be able to move out the way, it makes it much more difficult. And you won't just wing him in, you will take that little adjustment and step just a little quarter step to the side and look for a different angle with that overhand right. And that overhand right, to me, looks like a phenomenal weapon from Yard. So, able to talk about the left hook, and rightly so, but when he dips that overhand right, he drops the head sometimes, and it adds that extra weight to the shot, and it's a lethal weapon. You haven't got to hit you clean for it to hurt you, the worry. But also, if, like you said, Arthur's got a great jab, and if he can keep Yard on the end of that jab, then Yard could get frustrated. And also, Yard might go into that fight thinking he's a world champion in the making, thinking he just hasn't been crowned the world champion yet, but he's definitely got to be it. So he feels like he's doing Arthur a favour, that is a walk in the park for him. There's all these scenarios that could happen. Yeah, it's a good fight. If it gets made now after this pandemic, it's a fantastic little start.
Now it's time for your main event of the evening. Our Siesta and Siesta Boxing proudly presents eight highly anticipated rounds in the super welterweight division. This time I am up to this to Kaneki Ukrainka. Introducing your challenges at ringside, Andrei Chirinov, Evgeny Kruglik, Nikolai Visov. Referee Vinje, the man in charge of the battle, Vladimir Kavalenya. И сейчас встречайте боксера синего угла из столицы Великобритании. And now, please welcome, fighting out of blue corner, straight out to the capital of the United Kingdom, Kingsley Egbunike. Thank you.
Shigashev.
И его соперник из города Электросталь, Россия. And now, please welcome his opponent, hailing from Electrostal City, Russia, Сергей Shigashev.
Well, Shigashev was a good amateur, boxed for Russia internationally, boasted a win 10 years ago against Daniil Yelusinov, which, whenever it occurred, it's an impressive effort. Yelusinov went on to become a world champion in 2013 and Olympic champion in 2016. He had nearly 300 amateur fights. He had 258 wins, and he won bronze medals and silver medals at the national championships at 60 kilos and 64. So that is a sprawling career in the unpaid code, and he's gone 9-9 so far as a pro, and he's just kind of the ante in his last couple of fights. He hasn't though been in the ring since November 2018, which is a really long time ago. I'm not quite sure what the reasons for that are until recently. Obviously it's 21 months out, which at 32 years old is a significant break.
Боксер синего угла, желтый шорток с красной вековой полосой. Ему 27 лет, его рост 183 сантиметра, вес 70 килограммов, 300 граммов. В его активе 5 побед и лишь одно поражение. Пряником из Лондона. Fighting out of the blue corner, wearing yellow trunks with a red full tree. He holds a professional record of 5 wins and a single loss. He stands at 6 feet tall. Ему 32 года. Его рост 174 сантиметра, вес 75 граммов и 700 граммов. Он побеждал 9 раз и 4 нокаутом. Не знающий поражений, он представляет здесь столицу России. The fighter across the ring, wearing blue and red, all the way from Moscow, Russia. He stands 5 feet and 8.5 inches tall.
Big reception for Shigashev, and a big task for Egbunike, but a significant advantage in height there for the Londoner. You can see at the face-off, and they're both in very, very good shape. So Shigashev in the red and blue, Egbunike in the yellow and red.
Первый раунд. Раунд 1.
Shigashev looking to try and muscle his way onto the inside early on there, boxing out of southpaw stance. Shigashev just getting slightly too close there, shutting down his own space a bit. Egbunike looking for that jab, and that will be key, you would imagine. You'll need to try and keep that gap, maintain that distance between the two, and do it by landing that jab regularly.
So you've got to be careful here, Egbunike. He's got his hands up, but there's a big gap in between them. Just a little bit wide there. That's just what I was there. Shigashev there, especially from the southpaw stance. He steps with that right foot. That left hand can go right through that wide guard. You just got to keep that right glove just a little bit closer to your chin.
Just those elbows.
That left hand.
Those elbows flare quite wide as well, don't they? The body's a fairly obvious target for Shigashev there too. It's quite quiet in the early stage. It's just over a minute into round one.
Good there from Evchenko. It's hard to establish a jab against a southpaw who steps to the right. So you've got to hold him there, Evchenko, and then you've got to try and turn Shigashev if he can.
You can hear the corner encouraging him there just to get back on that jab as often as possible, just to shoot it out, try and find some kind of rhythm with it. Look for the right hand there. He turned a little bit square there, Egbunike, but Shigashev wasn't really in any position to do too much about it, which is orthodox now, the Russian. He's been looking for a way in, hasn't he, constantly, Shigashev, yeah. Barry, and he's not really found one yet.
I can write his tendon, because he's so, not so much the height here of Egbunike, but the reach is so long. I can understand he's no longer walking the shots and looking for that perfect punch. And also, because Egbunike is quite slender, he's probably thinking, if I can slip in close enough, really let go with a good body shot, good hook. And you will feel it.
Again, Shigashev just stoops in a little bit, looking for a left hand to the body. Took his feet in with him that time.
Just a cupping left hook there from Egbunike, but he let his hands go a little bit more in that round.
So one round down. Shigashev 9-0. He's the home fighter here. Egbunike on the road. First time boxing outside of the UK.
Yeah, he just needs, I mean, I understand he's being tentative and that's against a southpaw who's quite aggressive, but just needs him to land with somebody a little bit more significant. Just give him a little bit of confidence. Just didn't really commit to anything, Egbunike. He stayed safe. But he needs a bit of a little more forceful with the jab, or even with the right hand there, so a little bit scrappy and not really, I wouldn't say not much thought behind you, they're not fully committing, so then half throws it.
Seconds out.
He just needs to give something, Egbunike needs to give Shigashev just something to think about when he's coming forward. Because at the minute, he's allowed to get too close to him.
Round two.
So into the second, Shigashev just popping out his lead hand. Both of them just cancelling each other out at the moment. Nobody really wanting to commit. Egbunike, though, does step in, looks for a couple of single jabs in quick succession.
To get that little duelling with the lead hand, that's going to suit Shigashev better, because he looks like he'd be more committed there with a left hand in his southpaw stance, the backhand if you want to call it, to fire it through the middle. That's what he's looking for, is looking to make Egbunike draw a shot out so he can fire out through the centre.
Just stepped in behind that left hand there, Shigashev. Found the target with it, moved straight onto the shoulder. It's kind of a shot to nothing, really, because it's pretty much impossible to counter that if he gets through. Turns orthodox again here, Shigashev. Just trying out both stances early on.
Good little jab there for Egbunike. To be fair, he's been a little bit clawed, a little bit snapping with his jab, so he hasn't really been firing out really fast, but he's been falling well short, a little bit tense with it, but and with a good one there, just needs a little bit more confidence to deliver the shots.
Yeah. Nice left hand to the body there from Egbunike as he was on the ropes. Good purchase on that. Just dug that one in. Tall fighters can do some real damage to the body at times because they've just got those long levers.
Shigashev should throw the body. Shigashev should stay nice and low. I know he's looking for that shot over the top, but that big long body is right in front of him. You've got to pound away at that. That's something that we're doing at the minute, as you mentioned from the first round, really. There's a big target to hit there down below.
Plenty of encouragement coming in from the Egbunike corner. Plenty of advice. Shigashev just inching forward, prodding to the body with the jab. Heads just banged together on the inside there, off the back of a jab and a spin, really, from Egbunike.
That's Alan Gray in the corner, I think, here.
And down he goes. That was an absolutely perfectly timed punch there from Egbunike. And Shigashev, as he was moving in, just walked straight onto it, dumped him ceremoniously onto his back. Final few seconds of round two, so he'll be able to make it through to the end of the round without any problems here, Shigashev. But that is a tremendous finish there from Egbunike. And a 10-8 round for the visiting fighter. And it was a very, very neat bit of work.
Well, he was on the ropes, so it was a lovely, lovely left hook. Shigashev just got a little bit squared foot in the other when he came forward. A fantastic shot, really was. Sort of came from nowhere as well, to be honest. The pressure didn't really come in with anything so far, Egbunike. But that was a sweet, lovely, sharp left hook.
I think that was just about it, actually. I think that might have been it, but we didn't stay with it for long enough. I'm sure they'll give us a look at it a little bit later on, but it was just away to that right hand side of the ring. Shigashev was just looking to close in, and he just caught him on the way in, and obviously that doubles the impact as you're moving forward onto the punch. And it was a great bit of timing, and that'll give him confidence. He started well anyway, he started pretty well, Egbunike, and he will just grow from that, and it will show Shigashev. He didn't really look hurt, that he's got to be careful, that he's got to give him some respect, because it's not just a case here of being able to walk through him. It's not going to be as simple as that. He's going to have to try and set things up a little bit more.
But Shigashev got to be intelligent here, not panic. I think, I've got to get on him quick. That's a good right hand. Oh, he felt that.
Was a good right hand, and he just got put back on his heels there, Shigashev, and Egbunike was immediately across the ring after him. He could feel that. He knew that had got through, and that Shigashev was giving some ground there and just inching forward with that front foot there, Egbunike. He doesn't want to go crazy here, but if he feels he has an advantage, he has got to try and take advantage of it.
But what he needs to do is maintain that distance as he's coming forward. You've got to keep him nice and long. That long right hand there, was, I think the width of it, the speed of it, was a surprise there for Shigashev. Don't want to get too close where you can get caught yourself, and also where he can hold on to you. Oh, good left hook.
Good left hand, yes, as you say, on the move there. On the move as he just walked in, and he's caught him a couple of times. And Shigashev is looking disorganised in this round. He's looking like he doesn't really have any answers particularly. He's cut as well on the corner of that right eye. Moves into the orthodox stance. Egbunike just steps into him, throws that right hand straight down the middle. And again, that very nearly just clipped him on the chin. He's in trouble here, Shigashev. A minute remaining in this round.
Look at the confidence in Egbunike. You can see it. Full of it now, isn't he?
He absolutely is. It's bursting out of him. Shigashev tentative now as he looks to try and move in. Jabs, throws the right hand, and then again just moves straight in behind it. Egbunike just looking to try and turn him in the middle. The referee comes in and breaks him apart. And he's won this round comfortably, Egbunike. 10-8 in the last round. This one will be 10-9. If it continues in this fashion.
And after the first round, he wasn't looking great for him, was he? He looked a little bit tentative, and Shigashev looked like, you know, he'd come out
full of intent with a good start. It looked like he was maybe controlling things.
It's interesting to hear that.
I was going to say, he's the one who's got us out of the panic. No, when you panic, you get best tensed up and then you start snatching at your shots.
And it's interesting to hear the urgency from the Egbunike corner, because this is a 10-round fight, and as I said, you don't want to go crazy, you don't want to go too gung-ho and leave yourself wide open, but when you get a window of opportunity, and he definitely has that here, you've got to be brave sometimes, haven't you, and really commit to it, because he's banging trouble here, Shigashev, no doubt about it.
Well, he doesn't like it, he doesn't like getting hit, does he? That's no one likes getting hit, of course. I mean, he doesn't like it at all. The first thing he thought of was grab hold, but he's panicking into it when he gets caught. And that's a worry. So you can understand why Alan Gray in the corner shouting him to go forward. He's thinking, put it on this kid, and he might fold.
And he's picked up the cut as well, so that's something else to contend with. It looks like the blood's running clear of it, but we'll find out. Clear of the eye, I mean. And I like this from the corner, because as I say, he's away from home here, he's got an opportunity here. What you don't want to do is just, you don't want to give him a chance to recover here, Shigashev, and gain some confidence and just get a little bit of a foothold, maybe fiddle a couple of rounds, because you're away from home. You've got to, it shouldn't be the way, but you need to win big away sometimes.
Yeah, of course you do. And also, you don't want to, how many times do you people let people off the hook and then get knocked out themselves, or again, there, a little slip there, got caught with a little short right hand there. Shigashev panics every time he gets caught.
Well, the graphic on the left hand side has changed to round 4 of 8, and originally I did expect this to be an 8 rounder, then the number 10 appeared in that box earlier on, but they've changed it back again, so that changes things slightly, but not too much, because we're into the fourth round here. There's plenty of time to go. It makes it more difficult for Shigashev, if anything, because he's down here at the minute, and Egbunike is dominating this first minute of round 4.
That was nice there from Egbunike. He didn't land with every shot he threw, but he didn't close the gap with the shots. He stayed nice and long. He had full extension on every shot there. He didn't get too close with the feet and smothered any of his work. And that'll be important. Now the discipline's going to be important for him.
And if he can keep it, the longer this goes on, Shigashev may well lose it, because he could get a bit desperate. But just getting driven back there by the jab and by the intent of Egbunike, Shigashev getting a hold on the inside, looking to try and chuck a sneaky little right hand. There wasn't room for it.
Well, Shigashev, he had a plan, didn't he? You can see in the first round, he had a plan, you could see what they were going to do. There was a game plan in place, you could see it. Now, he looks like he doesn't know what to do. Let's be honest, that could all change with it with one shot, of course, and he might find his feet in a minute. But I think with the urgency of the corner, Alan Gray talking through it here, isn't it? That's the advantage of not having a crowd, you can hear everything. And good left hand there.
That's a decent left, Shigashev. Yeah, decent left hand straight down the pipe there from Shigashev. Egbunike was squared up a bit on the ropes there.
But Egbunike, for the most part, hasn't allowed him to get a foothold back into the fight. He's kept the pressure on. And he's fighting like a man who really believes.
Heading into the final 30 seconds of round 4, Shigashev would have won that opener 10-9, but since then, Egbunike won the second 10-8, the third 10-9, and he's winning this round, you would say. So that's a fairly healthy lead. It would be a 3-point lead at halfway, right to the stomach there from Egbunike, as Shigashev looks to try and come forward.
And that's important, because it's Egbunike, look at the work inside, not the smaller, the stockier guy who's leaning on him. You think Shigashev should be the one working away, and it's not, it's the other way around. In there, the fact that he's not bringing his feet too close, he's not stepping over himself, not squaring up, allows him to throw another shot just to keep Shigashev, you know, moving back, keeping him away. Even when you miss, you're not squaring up or getting too close to the pole or swing back a few. He has to retreat to regroup. And then you throw another one, you can push him back to the rope. I've got to be honest, I worried a bit with Egbunike after the first round. I thought it might be a hard night for him, but
Well, it all changed for that left hand in the second round, didn't it? Shigashev, up until that point, he was looking for those gaps. He was looking to try and maraud his way onto the inside. He wasn't doing it recklessly, but I don't think he'd seen anything up until that particular punch that had made him worry too much. And then all of a sudden he got caught. He found himself sitting on the canvas. And that just puts enormous doubt into your mind. A couple of good jabs there from Egbunike.
He's making the most of that long reach, isn't he? Nice long sharp jabs. And I don't think there's much weight on him, but they're whipping shots, so they're like slaps in the face. They're like little whips, little stingy shots.
Switch his stances there, Shigashev. And again, Egbunike looking for the jab. Shigashev trying to get something done on the inside, but it's just not all that convincing. He needs a bit of success here, Shigashev, from somewhere, just to try and get some confidence back in what he's doing and how he's trying to do it, because at the moment that conviction just isn't there.
Momentum's a funny thing, isn't it? Once you've got it, it's hard to lose it. You know, I mean, the guy really got to take it off you unless you take the foot off the gas, and Egbunike hasn't done that yet. I did chuckle just a few minutes ago, and 30 seconds ago, where Alan Grace, I don't know what shot it was, but he's going, come on, I can see it. Even I can see it, he said.
Well, they're just asking for the jab again and again and again. They just want him to pop it out, keep popping it out. And again, he just stoops in with the left hand and moves straight in behind it. He lost his balance a little bit there, Shigashev. But as you said, momentum is... It's amazing how quickly it can change hands. Because Shigashev had it in the first round. He looked confident. He's in front of a nominally a home crowd, really. And then it all changed. It all changed with that one punch that put an awful lot of doubt in his mind. It sent the confidence of Egbunike through the roof, but he's got to be careful because he got caught by a big smearing overhand right there. He just dipped his head as he came in, Shigashev, and he found the target. Egbunike was just caught a bit tall there. He needs to be on his game here all the way through.
Yeah, concentration is going to be key for him now, isn't it? We already sort of mentioned that, but he took it well to his credit, mind that. He kind of was a proper dipping hook over the top, he dipped the head and everything. Shigashev.
Long look there from Egbunike towards Shigashev. Another round in the bank for Egbunike, would you say?
Yeah, I would. I think, obviously, no, for me, Shigashev needs a knockout or a stoppage or a couple of knockdowns at least. You can't see it though, unless he lands with a real honey shot. It's hard to have to see that coming. I think, you know, Egbunike can keep that discipline now, keep the focus, don't make any silly mistakes then. Dance home to the win, I feel now. Because also Shigashev doesn't look, no, can get knocked down, getting hurt, that takes a lot of you. Really empty the tank at times. So he doesn't look like, when they're up close, and I think the telefactor, when they're up close, he's looking to hold. And it's Egbunike looking to work. And I think without the knockouts, without the knockdown, sorry, and I don't think that would have been the case.
Well, the referee's having a quick word. I'm not totally sure what that would be about, because I think this has been a pretty clean fight so far. They've come together every now and again, very contrasting kinds of styles and physiques, but I'm not seeing an awful lot wrong. The cut doesn't seem to be bothering Shigashev too much. That cut to the right eye, they seem to have done a pretty good job of it in the corner. I think the blood was running clear. 30 seconds into round six, and Egbunike again looking to try and put that 1-2 together, stepping into the jab. Decent jab comes back from Shigashev there.
Oh, nice right hand with that, Egbunike. And again, good shot.
Shigashev that time just moved in. Egbunike didn't supply the jab, and in he came, and he did a little bit better there with a bit more confidence.
Well, he squared himself up on the ropes there, Egbunike. That's why he got caught with a shot.
Egbunike with a jab, and then Shigashev just looking for the big overhand right again. I'm not sure exactly how clean it landed.
I think Egbunike just caught with a little short right hook there. Shigashev didn't fancy it too much. Shigashev got to try and get caught. He got to try and get his punches going in twos and threes here. The single shots and walking forwards not having the right effect. Those jabs are missing, but they're keeping Shigashev busy. I think that's important for Egbunike. It's not allowing Shigashev to get too long. Then he attacks. He's just done. I think he's trying to get rid of that long left hand.
Into the final 30 seconds, and again, he just looks for that big overhand right there. Shigashev misses with it, and then Egbunike ties him up and just looks to lean down on him, walks him back to the ropes, and that's tiring for Shigashev. That'll take it out of him in that kind of physical battle. He's going to come off second best. He does look strong enough, but he looks like he's wilting a bit in there, Shigashev, to be honest. Bell goes at the end of the round. Just in that physical kind of wrestle at the end of the round there. Maybe he was just letting it go so as to not put too much energy into it, but I don't know. Do you see what I'm saying there?
No, he's shattered because he's been knocked down, he's been hurt a few times, and also he's panicking though. He's chasing a fight which he shouldn't be chasing after that first round, for sure. So he's panicking. He's having a few good shots. He can't win the first game in Egbunike, but he's having a couple of shots in Egbunike. He's looking quite well. And also he's being peppered with that jab all the time. He's setting up attacks, and you get caught, you've got to sit back, and you've got to go again, you've got to reset. And that takes energy, mental and physical. It tires you out, and he looks like the fight is tired. Not tired enough not to be able to put on a big push, of course, but you'll get just frustrated, you're a little bit frustrated, you're a bit tired, and anxious that he's going to get beat in a fight that everyone probably thought he was favoured to win.
Well, there are two rounds remaining here, and Egbunike has got a significant lead here. Surely that previous round, the one we've just seen, was tighter, but it was Egbunike who was thrown with the more authority, and he's looked for that big overhand right hand there again, Shigashev, and he's managed to find a home for it once, but other than that he's not had too much success with it.
No, but he gets success with overhand right hook, but when he's inside he's not working away. And because he can hit with that overhand right hook, he should be working that body, dropping those hands, making Egbunike drop those elbows down to the top, then whip that shot over the top. He needs to set these attacks up.
Good jab from Egbunike, and then just stepped in, and Shigashev was just off balance there. Really speared in the jab that time, and Shigashev just leaning in, Egbunike standing his ground. Nice couple of jabs there from Egbunike, and just moving as well, turning, keeping Shigashev turning. And I think the corner will know, and the urgency from the corner has never changed, but I think they will know that they can't afford to coast these last couple of rounds and just box to the bell, assuming they're going to get this. They've got to go out and win these final two rounds as well.
That was good for Egbunike. Yeah, just a little spin off the ropes and a little short right hook, left hook. Again, not loads on it, but a little snapping shots and that's the eye, you feel.
Shigashev just leaning in. There's a bit of tape just trailing from the right wrist there, I think, of Shigashev, and the referee may well decide to get that sorted out. He's decided he's stitched Shigashev. That was better. Just quickened up the feet as he came in there and threw 2-3 combination punches as he was moving forward rather than that one single shot. But Egbunike wraps him up and the energy levels, the tank is almost empty here from Shigashev.
Yeah,
it is.
That was cute there for Egbunike. You've got to be careful, Egbunike. He's just pushing off with the shoulder. Making a little bit of space to get that uppercut into play.
And Egbunike just driving Shigashev back into the ropes. He didn't really land any of them, but that's what you were saying in the last round, Barry, is that even still, you know, he's dictated terms by doing that without really getting through with anything clean because Shigashev is giving ground.
What he's doing, though, is he's making Shigashev work really hard for very little success.
Well, they swap jabs at the end of the round, a touch of gloves, and one to go here. We've seen some entertaining fights. It was a good fight between Magomedov and Ballingall earlier on. I felt Ballingall was unlucky, and it was a good performance. It was enjoyable to watch. And in the last one we saw as well, Stempkowski and Baysarov was a strange old fight in some ways because of Baysarov's lack of conditioning, but they both still put plenty into it. This one's been an interesting fight because it was a good start by Shigashev. He looked every inch what his record suggested he would be, a confident home fighter. And he won that first round, but then he got put down in the second. And the fight just changed completely from that moment onwards. And he needs a knockout in this final round, Shigashev. Surely it cannot be that he could get this on the cards.
You wouldn't have thought so. Not certainly not on my card. He's a three different knockout.
I just want to go to the final round.
I've been so shocked with Egbunike. I was so pleasantly surprised. But after that first round, I thought this is going to be a horrible night's work for him, really hard. He looked tentative to let his hands go. And I thought that's no good. This guy's going to walk right through him. And once he caught me with that left hook on the ropes end, he's just going in confidence. And he looks the stronger of the two.
Sharp, he does. He's
committed with every shot he throws.
He's really
fit.
Good condition.
Yes, condition, yeah. He really is. That's Alan Grafey. Oh, good right hand. Shigashev there.
On the head. But Shigashev just not really
working?
Able to follow up. Exactly, he's just not following up, is he?
And he's holding. And Egbunike is then holding as well. He's doing the right thing. But he's holding, first of all. Turn him on the ropes. So you've got his arm in the right place there. The elbow's outside the arm. You've got to turn him now. You've got to take that shoulder down, bring that arm down to your hips, and then you turn. You get yourself off the ropes and you throw him into the ropes.
Shigashev again just coming in behind. A lead left that time, looking to bob with that big javelin-like overhand right at times. It was strange through the way through that one. Egbunike giving a little bit of ground, and Shigashev just trying to walk him back to the ropes. Egbunike may be just feeling the pace a little bit himself now as we enter the closing stages. Just needs to keep shooting that jab.
I think this has been a really good, unless something goes drastically wrong on the last minute, it's been a really good display here for Egbunike. He's kept his boxing together really well. He's been put under pressure as well, let's be honest. Fitness is superb. And you would think
probably would have if things hadn't turned so quickly. That this wrestling inside would have been with a favoured Shigashev, you would have thought.
You would, when you look at the physiques of the two at the start of the fight. You've got one long, lean kind of fighter, you've got the more bull-like fighter in Shigashev, and you would have thought physicality-wise, right here as we're looking at that kind of situation, that he would be the one who would really put it on him close up, but it's not proved to be the case. And that's a nice smooth right hand on the inside there to make the DK. Shigashev just trying to maul all over him towards the end of the round there. Never stopped trying there, the Russian. He was buzzed, I think, quite badly by that left hook in the second round and put him down. He was trying to find a way back in after that, but Egbunike, well, that's a tremendous performance. It's as simple as that. And from that second round onwards, on that one 10-8, and where I was watching from where I saw him, every round after that too, and I don't see any possible way that he's not going to win this fight. The judges may have found a couple of rounds in there for Shigashev, that's possible, but surely not enough to deny Egbunike the victory.
No, I thought he boxed really, really well, and a clear winner, but it really was, a real clear winner. Because the rounds, most of the rounds that he won clear. So they weren't like all real nip and tuck rounds where he just favoured him. He won his rounds quite clear, I thought. So I think I'd be really disappointed if he doesn't get the knock. The kick deserves it. Really good. Really, that's a great shot. Really good. But you can understand why Shigashev squared up, because he was so much in command. To be fair, man, he did not get up from that. When you see it from that angle, he was really, really heavily blocked.
He was. That was a perfect spot to see it from, because he almost just kind of touched it with the right hand first, and then that left hand just made perfect contact. Nice bend in the elbow, bend in the arm, picked up. Everything was right about that.
Do you know what?
I did get a great.
Sort of like this is a gamble for like, they come here and go, listen, let's just go for it. We'll hope you put a bit of luck. That's the truth. So if you think you're good enough to win, you hope for a bit of luck. The gamble paid off in my mind. It wasn't luck, he made his own luck, but the gamble paid off. And this could be a career changing fight for him if he gets the decision that he deserves. For his confidence, for his the perception of him as well in the game, especially back in the UK, and it could be a big step for him.
So where's our MC? The trainer just adjusting his shorts there as we're waiting for the man with the mic to slide through the ropes and tell us which way this one has gone. He's all smiles, our Egbunike there, absolutely convinced that he's done enough. Shigashev looks fairly resigned to his fate. But they're in for a little bit of a nervous wait here. Absolute silence in the arena. Here we go.
Пришло время огласить судейское решение. It's time for judge's decision. Judge Chividov, 75-75. Judge Krublik, 75-75. Judge Vissalov, 76-75.
Well, I don't. That's absolute garbage. Garbage is the right word. That is absolute garbage. And I think the third scorecard, 76-75, if he's reading them out, home corner first, away corner, it's absolute nonsense. 75-75, I don't even know how you get that score in an eight-round fight. when one round has been 10-8. I don't understand the maths there. I'm just trying to do it in my head.
Well, they don't give. They haven't given their own 10-8. Obviously.
Yeah, they can't have done.
They've obviously, he's won the round, so they give him, there's a 10-point miss system, and you take away the points for the knockdown, so they give it that way. But then it still doesn't make any sense. You would get that scorecard.
No, you wouldn't. Maybe he's not quite read it out right, the announcer. I'm not saying he's read, I'm not saying it wasn't a draw. Maybe the figures that he's read out weren't quite correct, because to give him credit, he's doing this in English, and it's not his native language. But that, I'm afraid that's an absolutely terrible decision. An absolutely,
to be honest,
terrible decision.
The two British kids, I don't know them. And to be honest, as much as I like to see them, I don't really care if they win or not. It's not affect my life.
No, they, well, we can't care, can we? Doing this job, you don't care who wins. I mean, it's as simple as that. But when somebody deserves to win, wherever they're from, you want to see them get the decision.
They got shot dead for me. This one. I sort of feel so fun of the back now, because I thought he got hard done by, but now my egg beneath these was much worse. That's going to be the focal point of it, because I thought he's more than he wasn't winning. Well, I thought he was dominant.
Yes, absolutely. I completely agree. But it's still a really good performance. It's still something for him to build on. It's not a defeat, it's a draw. And it's away from home, and it's ticked all sorts of boxes here, and he can go away safe in the knowledge that really this should be a win and try and treat it as such.
You know what? I can't say that, because I had a draw in my career, and I'm honest with my career, good or bad, I wasn't that great and all that shit. I won that fight here. I had fun in one of the few fights I had fun in. I won that fight in hand belt, and it was a terrible decision. But then, three fights later, I was a world champion. So it didn't do me any harm. I'm gutted it's on my record. I didn't deserve it. But three fights later, I was a world champion. So you're right. It was a draw. It wasn't a loss. And it won't hopefully impair his progression, because the kid deserves a chance now. But he boxed great. But he was absolutely fantastic.
Well, that concludes the action from the Diamond in Minsk, Belarus for tonight. That's the end of Kold Wars Part 3. We've got one more to come for you tomorrow. Some good fights tomorrow night. Please do join us again at 8:20. And we'll see you then.